bacterial endocarditis. Now every day you are just hearing about the corona, and today let us change the subject, so it will be changed to your mood also. I think you all are in better position. You are enjoying at home because your family is with you. So the one of the most important topic, that is called as bacterial endocarditis. You have seen what is seen in rheumatic heart disease. Vegetations are also present in rheumatic heart disease, but in endocarditis also there are vegetations are present. Now, classification of endocarditis. The simple definition of endocarditis, that is inflammation of the endocardium. So endocardium is a covering lining of the heart inside. So when there is inflammation of this endocardium, that is called as endocarditis. Unless otherwise proved, you are just calling, if wall endometrium that is involved, you are calling it as a endocarditis. When the wall of atrium or ventricle that is involved, that is called as dural endocarditis. If papillary muscles are involved, you call it as a papillary endocarditis. If cordy tendony that is involved, you call it as a caudal endocarditis. So what is the classification of endocarditis? Basically, there are two types. One that is called as non-infective, and second is called as infective type of endocarditis. Non-infective, the cause is not because of the infection. That is very commonly seen in case of rheumatic heart disease. Second, a typical varicose type of endocarditis. Everybody is audible? Hello? Can I continue? Okay, then it's fine. So there are basically two types, non-infective type and infective types. Non-infective, when there is no infection, commonest cause is rheumatic heart disease. That has been taken already in our last lecture. Second, that is called as a typical varicose type of endocarditis. Common word that is given as a Lippmann-Sachs endocarditis. What is that? That I will tell you in details. Third, that is called as non-bacterial thrombotic. NBTE, non-bacterial thrombotic endocarditis. So these are all three variants. It comes under non-infective types. Second is infective types. Always remember that before the antibiotic era, this was a very dangerous type of disease. Most of the people, they will march to the grave only, because it was very severe type of disease, that is called as bacterial type of endocarditis. Other infective types, they are also seen depending upon which type of organism. If it is because of the tuberculosis bacilli, you call it as a tuberculosis endocarditis. If because it is because of the fungus, fungal endocarditis. Third is the viral, that is called as viral endocarditis. So RHB 8 has been taken. Now we will switch over to the next, that is called as infective type of endocarditis. So what is infective endocarditis? It is, definition is, invasion or colonization of cardiac walls and endometrium by microbiological agents. So microbiological agents, along with the thrombotic debris, they form a polypoid structure, what you call as a vegetation or varicose. So how much is incidence? Incidence, this type of endocarditis that is common in the age of after 50 years. That is first thing. Second, it is more common in males as compared to the females. Now remember that if you see the clinical classification that I already taken, non-infective cause and infective cause. As far as infective endocarditis that is concerned, one, it is called as acute type of endocarditis. Second, it is called as subacute type of bacterial endocarditis. So remember two, acute and subacute. What is the difference that we will see? What is the basic difference between them? So acute versus subacute. So acute endocarditis. Acute endocarditis is very dreaded condition. It is caused by the highly virulent organisms. The most common is Staphylococcus aureus. It basically attacks the previous normal walls. So here there is no previous any heart disease. Absolute the wall is normal and it is called as causing endocarditis. And there is a high morbidity as well as mortality even with appropriate antibiotic treatment. Is it okay? That is acute endocarditis. So caused basically by the Staphylococcus aureus. Second type that is called as subacute type of bacterial endocarditis. Commonly the word it is SABE. Subacute bacterial endocarditis. So here it is caused by a low virulent bacteria. And the commonest is Streptococcus viridans. About 60% of the cases, they are caused by Streptococcus viridans. The characteristic feature is that here there is some heart disease. It may be congenital heart disease or it may be नेक्स्ट ऑफ देखते हैं। विचारलं गेलं परत
नाही हा विचारू शकतो काही अडचण नाही.
ते हे टाकायचं काय तुमचं
नाही गरज नाही सर, तुम्ही डायरेक्ट बोला सर, सर बोला डायरेक्ट.
नाही हे करतो ना काय ते चॅट बॅक्टेरिया and it involves when there is some deformed type of wall. The disease is insidious. It follows a protracted course from weeks to months, and most patients recover after antibiotic. So depending upon that, these are the 6 points which can differentiate between acute and subacute type of bacterial endocarditis. Duration is a short, less than 6 weeks in case of acute one, more than 6 weeks to months, it is subacute. Commonest organism, acute endocarditis, Staphylococcus aureus. In this case, so in subacute, it is caused by Streptococcal viridis. Virulence of organisms, it is highly virulent in case of acute one, low virulent in case of subacute one. Then previous condition of the wall, it is the previously the walls, they are normal in case of acute, while they are deformed in case of subacute. Lesion on the walls, lesion on the walls, these are the destructive, suppurative in case of acute one, while they are proliferative in case of subacute. What are the basic clinical features? In acute one, there is a high grade fever and features of septicemia, while in the case of subacute, there is a mild fever. Along with that, there are petechial hemorrhages, then there are the urethra spot, like that, that I will tell you subsequently. Let us see what is the etiology, what is the cause of the disease. I mentioned that subacute, it is caused by Streptococcal viridis. These are the normal flora. So during either dental surgery or in case of the filling of the tooth, extraction of the tooth, you are doing something in the oral cavity, these organisms, they are released in the bloodstream. After releasing, they go to the, in the blood and they settle down in the previously damaged wall. So damaged wall, it may be because of the rheumatic heart disease or because of the congenital heart disease. Second organism, that is called as Staphylococcus. Staphylococcus aureus, that is causing acute type of endocarditis. It is also caused by yeast cells, also candida. The next organism, Streptococcus pycnus. This is a normal, that is seen normally in the gastrointestinal. So in case of colonoscopy, in case of any gastrointestinal surgery, these organisms enter in the bloodstream, it causes endocarditis. Then Staphylococcus epidermidis, this organism, it is normally present over the skin. In case of skin injury or in case there is a boil, that organisms enter in the blood. From blood, it will go over these walls and cause endocarditis. Other organisms like Haemophilus, Antibacillus, that also cause the endocarditis. But never forget two important ones, Streptococcus viridis, that is called as subacute variety, and Staphylococcus, that is called an acute type of endocarditis. Now, how are the vegetations? You are seeing vegetations present in the rheumatic heart disease. They are smaller ones, right? Here, the vegetations are bigger one, they may be single or they may be multiple. They are larger in size because the lesion is proliferative type. So it is a club shape. And third thing, the most important, it is a friable. And because of this friability, that causes various types of formation of the emboli. Then it will involve one or multiple walls. That is also characteristic features. The most common wall that is involved, it is called a mitral valve. It is the most common name. Along with that, tricuspid aortic valves, they may be involved, but most commonly mitral valve that is involved. Ring abscess, it is a complication of acute bacterial attack of endocarditis. Then which are the source of infections? So these are the varieties of source of infection. Patients may be having boils, patients may be having ulcers, he may be having upper respiratory tract infection, there is infected teeth is there, puerperal sepsis is there, if there is indwelling catheters, then some patients with IV drug abusers, patients having acquired immunodeficiency syndrome, or he is having prosthetic valve or some cardiac surgery that has been done in that patient. So these are all are the sources of infection that is causing bacterial type of endocarditis. Then what are the predisposing factors? The most important is underlying heart disease. So if there is a heart disease, I mentioned it about this. There may be rheumatic heart disease, or there will be congenital heart disease. There will be mitral stenosis. There may be aortic incompetence. So multiple autoimmune states of heart disease. This is one of the important predisposing factors. Then impaired host defense. The defense of the host that is impaired. It may be because the patient is taking excessive antibiotics, or he is having the diseases like AIDS or lymphoma, leukemia. So these are the varieties of the things that causing the acquired type of host defenses. Infection spreading through the blood. So bacteremia, septicemia, and pyre. What is bacteremia? The bacteria, they get entry in the blood, that you call it as bacteria. If along with bacteremia, there are say signs and symptoms of septicemia, that is called as septicemia. If pyogenic organism that are causing the bacteremia, you call it as pyemia. Next predisposing factor is intravenous drug abusers. And last is a hemodialysis. So these are the multiple predisposing factors that is causing bacterial type of endocarditis. Now what is the pathogenesis? I mentioned there occurs a bacteremia. So these bacteria enter in the blood. It may be because of the dental surgery. It may be because of the colonoscopy. It may be because of the cut on the skin. So multiple things that causes the bacteria. So bacteria, they have gained the entry in the blood. From the blood, they are going to the heart. Now, there is a predisposing factor, like suppose that rheumatic heart disease is there. So there is some problem in the wall. The wall is abnormal. So bacteria, they get lodged there. Over that, the platelets and thrombin, it also get lodged, and it causes the formation of vegetation. Right? But if the wall is normal, but the bacteria, they are highly virulent, that is in case of the staphylococcus aureus, in that case it causes acute type of endocarditis. So platelet and fibrin get deposited on the damaged wall. Along with that, there are clumps of bacteria. So all these multiple things, they are forming a polypoid structure that you call as vegetation. So lesion, it may be cardiac. You will see the cardiac lesion in the form of stenosis, in the form of incompetence, in the form of myocarditis, or there is a formation of the vegetation. So these are the cardiac type of lesions. There may be embolic lesions. I told you, the vegetations are large. They are friable. That's why emboli are very common. These emboli, they are lodged at various places, depending upon the site. If it is arising from the left, at left ventricle, it will form a systemic emboli that will go to the kidney, that will go to the spleen, it causes infarction. If it's going from the right side of the heart, it will go cause the pulmonary infarction. And the general changes, it may be like the fever, amyloidosis, or there may be kidney involvement also. So what is the morphology? In the morphology, you will see what are the gross features, what are the microscopic features. So I mentioned about the vegetations. So vegetations, basically they are formed by the bacillum plus granulation tissue plus inflammatory cell infiltrate, right? All this is forming vegetations. So what is the gross abscisse? These are the club-shaped vegetations. They are present over the surface of the fall. They are having the stalk. They are large and they are friable. They overhang from the margins, and because they are friable, there occurs a formation of the embolization. Vegetations, they spread in the myocardium also. This causes necrosis and forming ring abscess. This is commonly seen in case of acute type of endocarditis. In the microscopic examination, you will see that the base, it is formed by the granulation tissue. So granulation tissue, there are inflammatory cells, there are fibroblasts, and there are capillaries. So this is the base that is formed by the granulation tissue. Over that, there is a layer of fibrin and platelet. Over that, so there is a second layer formed by fibrin and platelet. Third layer, that is forming bacterial colonies. Like streptococcal viridans, bacterial colonies are formed. And over that, again, you will see a fibrosis as well as fibrin deposition. So basically, you are seeing the four layers. The base layer formed by granulation tissue. Over that, there is a layer of fibrin and platelet. Over that, there are bacterial colonies. Over that, again, there are fibrin and platelets. In case of chronicity, you will see that there is a formation of fibrosis and calcification. So this is a nice picture. You can see here endocarditis. So they are mentioned in the infection of the innermost layer. Compare with the healthy wall. This is a normal wall, and this is an infected wall. You can see these are the multiple vegetation. They are present over the heart wall. So that is seen in case of the bacterial type of endocarditis. So again, these are the nice picture. You can see these are the vegetations that you can see. This is over the heart wall, and this is a pictorial diagram. This is a mitral wall. You can see in the green, you can see these are the vegetations. This is aortic wall. In aortic wall also, you can see the vegetation. This is a high picture in which you can see the vegetations in green very clear. So this is a schematic diagram. How this is going? You can see this is the mouth. I have mentioned that you are doing some dental surgery, extraction of the tooth from the mouth and this oral cavity. The bacteria, they are gaining in the entry. They are from blood. It is gaining entry into the heart. Over that, you can see the deposition of the platelet and fibrin. Ultimately, it is forming the vegetation. So bacteria can come mouth. They can come from the skin. They can come from the gastrointestinal tract. So this is a blood flow. As the walls, they are abnormal. There is a stagnation of the platelets and fibrin. And ultimately, this is completely, it is causing a vegetation. So these are the vegetations that you can see here in the heart wall. It is a characteristic feature of endocarditis. This is a microscopic feature. So here you can see the granulation tissue. These are the bacterial colonies. This is the fibrin and platelet deposition. This is again fibrin and platelet deposition. So this what you will see in case of microscopic examination for endocarditis. Now prosthesis, in some patients you are doing the prosthesis. In that, the most common complication is the formation of the ring abscess. This is because acute bacteria like Staphylococcus aureus, they get lodged there, they form suppuration, they form necrosis. That's why wall it get dislodged, and it will lead to formation of the ring abscess. Healing lesion, I mentioned that there may be fibrosis or there may be calcification. Bacteria, they get destroyed. Vegetation undergo fibrosis and calcification. So what are the common clinical features? The most common is the fever, followed by the cardiac murmurs. Cardiac murmurs, it is because of the vegetation formations. It will lead to formation of cardiac murmur. petechial hemorrhages, there are the small punctate type of hemorrhages that are seen in the skin. There is splenomegaly. Splenomegaly, because it is because of the emboli, they get lodged in the splenic vent, and that causes splenic infarct, causing the splenomegaly. And osteolar lobes. What are these osteolar lobes? These are again the embolic phenomena. They are seen in the tip of the fingers. They are very painful things that you can see here. That is called as osteolar lobes. So you can remember the word them. If you can remember this word, you can remember the clinical features. F stands for fever. Anemia is there, second feature. M, that is heart murmur, is there. And E, these are the embolic phenomena. So these are the common clinical manifestation that can be seen in case of the endocarditis. So this is a nice diagram. In a short diagram, you can see here what are the features here. So rose spots, these are the spots that are present in the retina. Splinter hemorrhages, they are seen over the nails. Over the nails, you will see the small hemorrhages, that is called as splinter hemorrhages. Janeway's nodes, they are commonly seen in acute endocarditis. These are the Janeway's nodes. These are the painless maculopapula. So what is the difference between osteolar and Janeway's? Osteolar nodes, they are painful. Janeway's nodes, they are painless. So these are the common mitral wall and tricuspid wall that is involved. Tricuspid wall, that is commonly involved in case of the high ventricles. So like what you have seen in rheumatic heart disease, there are Jones criteria, major criteria and minor criteria. But here you will see it is called as Duke's criteria. Duke's criteria for the endocarditis. There are two major criteria. Number one, first in echocardiogram, you will see the new murmur, that is one characteristic feature. And second, two consecutive blood culture taken between duration of 12 hours. If they are positive, that indicates that these are the major criteria. And what are the minor criteria? Minor criteria, known case of the patient having heart disease. Second, fever. Third, only one positive culture. Fourth, echocardiographic findings. These are the minor criteria. So for the diagnosis of endocarditis, there may be either two major criteria. Both are there, you call it as an endocarditis. Or one major, and three minor criteria. That also, that is one criteria. Or all five minor criteria that have been seen in case of the Duke's criteria for endocarditis. What is the diagnosis? How will the diagnose the case? I mentioned you about the what are the Duke's criteria for the diagnosis. So what is diagnosis can be done with the help of the blood culture or echocardiogram. What are the poor prognostic factors? When you will consider that the prognosis is poor, in that non-streptococcal etiology, that is the first criteria. Second, development of the heart failure. Third, aortic wall involvement. If mitral wall involvement is there, it has got comparatively better prognosis. Infection on the prosthetic wall that will lead to ring abscess, that is also a dangerous sign. Old age. So all these are the negative prognostic factors. These are the complications. Complications, first is abscess wall formation that I have mentioned. Second, perforation of aorta and interventricular septum. These are the one of the complication. Next, valvular stenosis and regurgitation, suppurative pericarditis, embolism, and antimicrobial prophylaxis. These are the common complications that are seen in the endocarditis. So this is a nice diagram. What is the sequelae of infective endocarditis? Now you can see this is the mitral wall. These are the vegetations, and it is causing the stenosis. Second, this is the ring abscess. This is abscess that is causing Then myocardial abscess. Here you can see that there is involvement of myocardium, or there is a suppurative pericarditis. So this is a pericardial wall. This is a myocardial wall. This is endocardium. So these are the complications, and these are the non-cardiac complications. There may be formation of the embola in the brain. You can see here small petechial hemorrhages over the skin. It is called as petechial hemorrhages. Then, because of embola, there occurs focal necrotizing glomerulonephritis involving the kidney. There is a splenic infarct that causes the splenomegaly. There is a lung, you can see emboli that can be seen. Osler node that I mentioned. So these nodes, they are present over the tip of the fingers. It is very painful node. Or a Janeway spot that is seen in the acute bacterial type of endocarditis. These are the painless. So always remember, osler node, they are painful. Janeway's node, they are painless. So these are the Roth spots that can be seen in the retina. So this is a Roth spot. This is a Roth spot. These are the retinal hemorrhages with pale center. You can see this is a retinal hemorrhage that has occurred here, and there is pale center that is a characteristic feature of SAVE. So what is the difference between Osler node and Janeway's nodes? So these are Osler nodes. You can see these are the painful lesions over the pulp of the finger. And these are the maculopapular Janeway's node that are seen over the palmar side, thinner side of this palm. So Janeway's nodes seen in acute endocarditis. Osler nodes, they are seen in the subacute type of bacterial endocarditis. So again, these are the same diagrams. You can see these are the painful node, these are the Osler nodes. Again, Osler nodes, these are painful erythematous. You can see they are very highly painful. These are the sphincter hemorrhages. I have mentioned you about them. They are seen commonly in case of subacute type of bacterial endocarditis. So these are the sphincter hemorrhages. Roth spots, they are commonly seen in 5% of subacute bacterial type of endocarditis. So what are Roth spots? These are the retinal hemorrhages with pale center that you can see here. Again, this is a picture of the Osler nodes. They are not only involving the hand, but they are involving the feet also. Again, the same picture, Janeway's node and Osler nodes. You can see here, these are the Janeway's nodes, right? Here you can see the Osler nodes. You can see some splinter hemorrhages also. Kidneys involved, I have mentioned that that is one of the embolic phenomena, and that will lead to glomerulonephritis type of nephritis. So this is a typical feature. It is called as flea-bitten kidney. So whenever there is a flea-bitten kidney type of appearance, think about the few things. The most common, it is because of the malignant hypertension. Second, infective type of endocarditis. It may be seen in good posture syndrome and rapidly progressive glomerulonephritis and SLE. So these are, you can see flea-bitten, like flea has bitten the kidney, and that is typically it is given a flea-bitten type of appearance in case of kidney. Now, before going to Lippmann sac, if anybody is having some questions, okay, fine. Next type of endocarditis that is called as Lippmann sac of endocarditis. Now this is Lippmann sac type of endocarditis. It is also most commonly seen in case of the CSL. So that is the one type of the collagen disorder, systemic lupus erythematosus. So that is a characteristic feature that is seen in SLE, or also it is seen in thrombotic type of thrombocytopenic purpura. So here the characteristic picture is that the lesion is small, so there are small vegetations. They are present on the both surfaces. The lesions in rheumatic heart disease as well as bacterial endocarditis disease, they are seen only on one surface and they are seen at the closure of the margin. Here you can see the lesions are small, they are sterile, and embola formation will not never occur in case of Lippmann sac of endocarditis. It may be single or it may be multiple. And what microscopically, you will see that there is a fibrinoid type of necrosis. Along with that, you will see that fibrin and platelet formation is there. Inflammatory cells like histiocytes, plasma cells, lymphocytes, that is also seen. And one most important thing, it is called as hematoxylin bodies. So these hematoxylin bodies, they are nothing but they are the counterpart of ELE cells, lupus erythematosus cells. That is a characteristic feature of SLE that will be seen in case of Lippmann sac endocarditis. The most common wall that are involved, the commonest is a mitral wall followed by tricuspid. So this is a diagram, four diagrams that will show the different types of vegetations. So sometimes question may be asked, vegetations in the heart. So you will have to mention that commonly seen in the rheumatic heart disease, infective endocarditis, non-bacterial thrombocytic endocarditis, and Lippmann sac of endocarditis. So this is the difference between four. You can see here, in Lippmann sac, it is seen over the both side, this side also, as well as this side. In the rest of the three, you can see only from the one side. In endocarditis, these are the large vegetations. They are larger, club-shaped, and they are fried. That's why embola formation, it is commonly seen in infective endocarditis. In RHD, they are smaller ones, but they cause a lot of deformity. In non-bacterial thrombocytic endocarditis, you can see these are the larger than rheumatic heart disease. They may be single or they may be multiple. So non-bacterial thrombotic endocarditis. So there is no infection. That's why it is called as non-bacterial. There occurs a formation of the thrombi. That's why it is called as thrombotic and it is endocarditis. What it consists of? It consists of the clotted RBCs, WBCs, platelets, and fibrin material. They are sterile. They may be single or multiple that I already shown here. So these are the that is seen for vegetations in NBTE. They are seen in most commonly deep vein thrombosis, sepsis, patient having cancer. Most commonly it is seen in mucinous type of adenocarcinoma or cachexia of any cause. All this will lead to non-bacterial thrombotic endocarditis. They are also friable and they cause embolic phenomena. So this is all about endocarditis. So whenever so vegetations are seen, it may be because it may be infective cause or non-infective cause. Non-infective, it is mostly because of the antigen antibody reaction that you can see in the rheumatic heart disease. So rheumatic heart disease, Lippmann sac endocarditis, and third is a non-bacterial thrombotic endocarditis. These are the non-infective causes. Infective causes, infective endocarditis, there are two types: acute endocarditis, subacute bacterial endocarditis. Acute caused by the Staphylococcus aureus and subacute caused by the Streptococcus viridis. Now you can see here, this is a case, 32 years old male, known case of RHD. He has undergone mitral wall repair. He presented to the emergency department with the fever, chills and rigors, myalgia and shortness of the breath. On examination, he was normotensive, tachycardia there, he is febrile. Systemic examination result, parasystolic murmur. Feel in the mitral area, there is a splenomegaly. So, known case of rheumatic heart disease, along with splenomegaly, along with fever, along with that, there is a sphincter hemolysis. Right? they are present on their nails, and red tender lesion over pulp of left middle and ring fingers. So these are nothing but these are the osteoid nodes. So this is a typical case of subacute bacterial type of endocarditis. That's all. Thank you very much. कस कर
शेयर स्टॉप शेयरिंग
इत हाँ आल का नहीं रिप्लाय थैंक यू सर ओके किती आले मला दाखव
आज हा ते स्टॉप केलं दिसतं सर ते पाण्याचे चॅटिंग वर आहे सर 68 आहे 60 करू